بركاته. بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن اهتدى بهداه وبعد. All praise is indeed due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Blessings and salutations upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless every single one of us and to make us from those whom He has forgiven tonight. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us a new beginning. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us from those who take heed, to make us from those who learn lesson, to make us from those who seize the opportunity to learn His word and to put it into practice. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala never ever to make us from those who lose hope in His mercy. Amen. Honored ulama, beloved brothers and sisters and dearest listeners, this evening we have an extremely important subject, so important that it affects every single one of us. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has warned us, saying, "Innahu nisful ilmi." It is half of all knowledge. It is half of all knowledge. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam continues to tell us, "Innahu yunza." It is going to be taken away. "Wa innahu awwalu ma yunza'u min ummati." It is going to be the first knowledge that is going to be taken away from my ummah. What is this? I'm sure a lot of people would like to know what it is. Before I tell you, let me explain to you yet another point. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, there will come a time when people will dispute regarding it and there will be no one to guide them, no one to tell them what is right and wrong. And even if there was someone to tell them what is right or wrong, they wouldn't tell them, fearing a backlash or fearing, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us, the material wealth of this world. So what is the subject? The subject is the laws of inheritance in the Sharia. These laws are stipulated by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The reason is, the wealth that Allah gives me, it is not up to me to use it how I want. I can use it only within the framework that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has dictated and has set down. And this is something of utmost importance. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to open the doors for every single one of us. When we have money in our pockets, let's not think that we can use it wherever we want. We can use it for as long as it does not contradict what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has stipulated. We can use it for as long as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not be upset because of us using it in something prohibited. And this is what we need to realize. So what this means is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us wealth and He gives us a framework around which we will be utilizing and making use of that wealth. Outside that framework is not allowed. If that is the case whilst we are living, then surely even after we have passed away, it is completely prohibited to do whatever we would like. We need to do what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has stipulated. And this is why the laws of inheritance have been mentioned very, very clearly. When it comes to salah, when it comes to the acts of worship such as prayer and zakah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has explained the prayer, but not in detail in the Quran. Rather, the detail is found in the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Exactly how to bow down, when to bow down, or when to go for ruku', when to go for sujood, and how it is done, what to say, and so on. That explanation you will find in the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and in the hadith, in the life of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, may peace be upon him. But when it comes to the laws of inheritance, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala Himself has explained in the greatest possible detail, more than He has explained any other act of worship. And this all happens to be more so in one surah. Which is that surah? It is known as Surah An-Nisa, the surah named after the women folk. And why does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make mention of the laws of inheritance in the surah after the women folk? Because many people cheat their women when it comes to inheritance. Many people deceive the females. Many people miscalculate and do not give them sometimes. And if they were to give them, they would undervalue the properties so that they only make them happy. You know, when you talk of an estate worth 10 million rands and you tell a woman, you know, yours is 100,000 rands, she'll be excited, subhanallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us protection. But if her share is 2 million or 3 million and we were only making her happy by a figure that she became excited with, in that case we are eating from the pieces of Jahannam, from the pieces of hellfire. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. And this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala opens the surah by making mention of certain points regarding women and regarding the orphan children, more so the female orphan child. Though both the orphans are included, male and female, but the lesson is more for us regarding the female orphan child. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, before I tell you the verses that He has mentioned, let me explain to you what used to happen in the pagan days, what used to happen before Islam. A woman was regarded as property. A woman was regarded as merchandise. When someone owed someone else a large amount of money, they would then take along their daughter and go and give her and say, thank you very much. And they would write off the debt. Sometimes they would give out their wives and they would give out their mothers and sisters in order to be absolved of a debt that they owed somebody else. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. That was what used to happen. When a man dies, his wife was inherited by those whom he owed money to, or his wife was inherited by a brother or by an uncle or by someone else, or they would write a will saying, when I die my wife must go to so and so, my mother must go to so and so, my daughter must go to so and so. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. So a woman was regarded as property. Up to today there are certain cultures, when a woman gets married they charge money to give her off because they consider her a piece of property. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. When I say they charge money, the father wants an amount. He says, look, I looked after her when she was young, you've got to give me 10,000 rands. The mother says, look, I had this, so please, you need to give me so much. And the uncle comes and says, hang on, when she went to school, she lived at my house, so I need so much. All this is pagan. In Islam, it is unacceptable. In Islam, when marriage occurs, there is a small gift known as a mahar. It does not translate as the word dowry, but we can call it dowry for as long as we understand that it's not the exact term. A mahar is a gift from the groom to the bride. It is just a mere gift, subhanallah, declaring that from today onwards, the responsibility of your food, clothing and accommodation is upon myself. And that responsibility, the man is taking that responsibility, giving her a token, and that token is a mere gift known as a dowry. The father gets nothing. The mother and the others get nothing. Yes, if someone wants to give a gift, it's up to them. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us understanding. So, remembering that background, when Islam came, when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came, the first thing he did is he prohibited the burial of girls. You know, people become upset when they have a girl child. They become very angry sometimes. May Allah protect us. But at that time, everyone used to get upset. They say, this is a girl. She's not going to carry on my name. I rather have a boy who's going to carry on my name, my lineage. So they used to take the girls one day and play with them and take them and dig a hole and put them in the hole and tell them, hang on, we're covering, we'll open just now. They cover it, they never open. May Allah protect us. And this is why the Quran says,
وَإِذَا الْمَوْءُودَةُ سُئِلَتْ بِأَيِّ ذَنْبٍ قُتِلَتْ.
When the female child who was buried alive will be asked on the day of Qiyamah, what was the sin that made you be buried alive? There was no sin. Allah says, on that day, we will serve justice by taking to task those who buried her alive. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect us. So the first thing that was prohibited, it was prohibited to bury a girl child. Over and above that, it is prohibited to have a bad feeling in the heart when you are blessed with a female child. And if you have had that bad feeling, you need to seek Allah's forgiveness. Because some people say, I need a boy, I need a boy, I need a male. And when your wife gives birth to a female, you get upset, oh no, it's the fourth girl. Allahu Akbar, the hadith says, anyone who has girls, looks after them, and gets them married off, gives them a proper upbringing, gets them married off to people who are reasonable and decent, Allah will give them paradise in return. Subhanallah. Now how many of us want girls? Allahu Akbar. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us whatever is best for us, boys or girls, for as long as they are healthy, obedient children. We thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has declared and decreed that not only is it prohibited to treat a female as property, but you need to acknowledge that she has the right to own property. Subhanallah. And this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah An-Nisa regarding the women,
وآتوا النساء صدقاتهن نحلة فإن طبن لكم عن شيء منه نفسا فكلوه هنيئا مريئا.
You must give the women folk that gift or that mahar or that dowry, if you'd like to call it. And you must give it to them in full, and they are the owners of it. You must not take from it unless they themselves at their own discretion decide to give you from it or to give you some wealth, then you may eat it happily. Otherwise, it is their wealth. They can spend it wherever they want, and still the food, clothing and accommodation of every female is a duty upon her closest male relative. This is something many people don't understand. When a woman gets married in Islam, she does not need 1 cent. She does not need a penny, because her basic necessities of food, clothing and accommodation of a basic standard, who owes it to her? Her closest male relative, in which case it would be her husband. If she doesn't have a husband or she is widowed and has an adult son, then the adult son is the closest male relative. If she doesn't have sons, then the father. And even prior to marriage, it is the father. And if she doesn't have the father, nor husband, nor sons, then the brothers. If not the brothers, then the uncles, and so on. Subhanallah. Did we know that? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. In fact, so much so that if she does not have any male relatives at all, it is the duty of Jama'atul Muslimin, the congregation of Muslims, to take care of that particular female in her response, in her basic necessities of food, clothing and accommodation. So that is the background, and now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about the orphan child. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in this particular surah,
وَآتُوا الْيَتَامَىٰ أَمْوَالَهُمْ وَلَا تَتَبَدَّلُوا الْخَبِيثَ بِالطَّيِّبِ.
Give the orphan child his or her wealth, and don't change the wealth of an orphan which is good with what you have which is bad. So sometimes what people do, the father has left some merchandise, the father has left some goods, some stock, and the father passes away. So there comes a guardian, seeing that these orphans are young, or it's a girl, it's a female, let's just change all these beautiful irons which are Mullinex irons, mashallah, that is in the business, and let's put in these Chinese irons. I'm not saying Chinese irons are bad, please, but I am saying that they are much cheaper. Allahu Akbar. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us barakah in our business, whether we are selling Chinese stuff or Japanese stuff. What beats me is the two countries are right next to each other. But if you say Japanese, I don't know why, it holds a value that the Chinese don't really hold. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. That's not our topic tonight. However, let's continue to make mention of how it is prohibited to change that which the orphan has been given by the one who is deceased, and change it with what you have, or try and usurp it, or try and undervalue it. Sometimes they've left properties and you want the property. So you go to the female and say, you know what? That house is worth 2 million rands. I'm going to give it to you. And you know deep down it's worth 10 million. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all protection. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says regarding this particular issue, the issue of giving back the wealth to the orphans in Surah An-Nisa. Remember, all the verses I'm going to quote for you tonight will be from Surah An-Nisa. If I mention otherwise, then it will be from a different surah. But this surah is the surah of women, because it is close to the hearts of women. When they are cheated, when they are deceived, they are definitely from amongst those who don't know much at times about business dealings and about property values and so on. And this is an address to the men folk, telling them that be careful how you deal with the women folk. Don't cheat them, don't deceive them, even the orphans. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says,
إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يَأْكُلُونَ أَمْوَالَ الْيَتَامَى ظُلْمًا إِنَّمَا يَأْكُلُونَ فِي بُطُونِهِمْ نَارًا وَسَيَصْلَوْنَ سَعِيرًا.
Those who eat the wealth of orphans, or who deceive the orphans, they are eating the fire of Jahannam in their bellies. They are eating the fire of hell in their bellies. And Allah says, we will then cast them into that fire. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all protection. So when a person passes away, what should happen? The reality is, I do not have a choice as to what is going to happen with my wealth, nor do you. I do not have a say, nor do you. In Islam, it is prohibited for anyone to think that when they die, they have a choice as to where their money is going to go. No, you don't. And no, I don't. If you did not know that, listen very carefully tonight. There is no scope for myself or yourselves to decide what is going to happen with my wealth when I die. Nothing. It is Allah's decision and Allah says that. So remember this. When Allah says you have to give someone, you have to give them. When Allah says you are not allowed to give someone, you will not be allowed to give them. When Allah says you can only give them a fifth, you can give them a fifth. In fact, a fifth is an equation that is not really used when it comes to inheritance. Let's use a quarter, or an eighth, or a sixth, or a third, or two thirds, or half. Allahu Akbar. These are equations that are used in the Quran. These are proportions that are used in the Quran. It is Allah who decides what will happen with my wealth. When I am alive, I can give it within the limits of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as a gift to whomsoever I wish. If I have children, whilst I am alive, I should try my best to be fair when it comes to giving them whatever I am going to give them. So if I give one child 20,000 rands, I need to give the other child 20,000 rands, male or female. They are equal whilst I'm alive. Whilst I'm alive, male or female are equal. And I must try to be just between my children because that is something extremely important. Remember, when children are very young, very small, we need to realize that if we favor one over the other, it will result in an inferiority complex with one and a superiority complex with the other. And it can have far-reaching mental, emotional effects that will only be felt many decades later. May Allah protect us. So that is why we need to treat all our children equally. You kiss one, you kiss the other. You buy something for one, you buy for the other. Yes, if one needs to be reprimanded, you reprimand them within the limits. But you don't go beyond the limits. And remember something, don't praise one too much in front of the other. That is oppression. This is regarding our own children. Now if we are meant not to praise one too much over the other or in the presence of the other, then what do you think about wealth? Do you think we'll be allowed to be giving large amounts to one and the other one we say, no, this one doesn't spend. Think very carefully and sometimes write down how much money one of your children has taken from you and ask yourself, how much have I spent on the other one? Wallahi, some of our children become greedy because we have a soft spot for them. Whilst we don't realize, we accuse the other ones of being greedy, yet they are not. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us and may He grant us understanding. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that when a person passes away, the first things you need to do with their wealth, three things. One is the burial costs. The burial costs of myself and yourselves must come out from my own estate. Unless there is someone in my family or friends or relatives who would like to volunteer with that amount, then there is no problem. I think in most cases, many people volunteer, the brothers or the family members, and they give that wealth. When it comes to burial expenses, the kafan, the enshrouding, the costs, the certificate, the death certificates and so on, all that by right should come out of the estate. If someone volunteers, it will be a good deed for them. The next thing that happens immediately is the issue of paying the debts of the deceased. Remember one thing, to go and borrow money in Islam is completely forbidden. To borrow money from someone and to borrow something from someone is totally prohibited. It's a major sin, unless you really need it. So there is actually an exception. When you borrow money from someone, why do you want someone else's wealth with you? Do you know how serious a crime that is? If you really need it, yes, it's allowed. If you really need it, there is an exception. There is permissibility. But the blanket rule is that it's not allowed unless it is needed. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to come after someone has passed away and the janazah was ready. And he used to stand in front of the dead person to read the prayer. And he used to look back and ask the companions, "A'alayhi daynun?" Does he owe anyone any money? And if they said yes, he would turn around, walk away and tell them, "Sallu ala sahibikum." You guys or you people, you sahaba radiallahu anhum, you can continue with the salah. I am going away. I cannot make dua for someone who owes someone else money. Allahu Akbar. That is how serious it is. So much so that the sahaba used to weep. They used to cry. When the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam used to be walking away, that one or two of them used to say, ya Rasulallah, O Messenger of Allah, alayya daynuhu, I will pay that debt of this particular person. Come and read salah. Then he used to look back, turn and come back, and then he used to say, Allahu Akbar for the janazah. Subhanallah. That is how serious it is to borrow money from people, to be in debt. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us from amongst those who can pay our debts quickly. And may He make us from those who are not too inclined into borrowing, borrowing, borrowing. Today the trend is the house is not yet paid. The car is not yet paid. The business is not yet paid. This is not yet paid. Everything is hire purchase. Allahu Akbar. When such a person dies, what happens? The system of the dunya will probably take half of the things away and will take what you've already paid more than three quarters for. It will be taken away. Why? Because we've indulged in a system that is unacceptable Islamically. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. So the point I'm raising here is when a person passes away, the second thing we will do is pay their debts. Then if you still have excess money, there is some scope that Allah has allowed myself and yourselves. And let's listen very carefully. This is a lesson, and this is a lesson in the laws of inheritance. The scope that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has permitted, He says, up to one third of your wealth, let's listen very carefully, up to 33.3% recurring, up to one third of your wealth, you are allowed to bequeath it at your discretion on conditions. And those conditions are as follows. Let me repeat that. Up to 33% of your wealth, you are allowed to write it for someone whom you desire on condition that it is not a person whom Allah has already given a share. Like your son, your daughter, your father, your mother and your spouse. You are not allowed to change that share. Neither decrease it nor increase it. But a person who's not going to receive anything, let's say for example, you have a relative or you have a son who's not a Muslim and you are a Muslim. Now, from the laws of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that child who's not a Muslim will not receive anything. But Allah allows you to give them something at your discretion up to 33%, which means the entire bequest must not exceed 33%. So now you can write there to say, look, my other sons and daughters who are Muslims, they will receive so much, but I accepted Islam, the son of mine did not. I tried with him and so on. I still feel he's a good child. I'd like to give him 5% of my entire estate. There's nothing wrong with that. He will get it even though he's not a Muslim. Why? Because that Allah left at your discretion. But if you did not write it, he won't get it. Because Allah says, whether you write or you do not write, we will distribute your estate, all of it. But if you have written up to 33.3%, you are allowed to state whom you would like to give wealth to. Maybe you had a maid who worked very hard and she accepted Islam and you would like to acknowledge it by writing, when I die, give her 10,000 rands. There's nothing wrong with that. You want to give 10,000 rands to a masjid. You want to give 100,000 rands to an orphanage. You want to do good deeds. For as long as that amount does not exceed 33.3%, or the entire amount does not exceed 33.3%, you are allowed to write it down and to request it and bequest it. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us understanding. Let's move a little bit further. So now this is regarded as what is known as wasiyyah. Wasiyyah means the bequest. That is the third thing that I have to fulfill on behalf of the deceased if I am the executor of that particular will. Or if I am the guardian of the person who's passed away, or if I am the person whom they have left behind. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us all strong. Now, if a person has written more than 33.3% for someone, then it is the duty of the person who is executing the will not to fulfill it all, meaning not to fulfill it more than 33.3%. And this is something we need to understand, because if that person did it intentionally, they will be punished. And if they did it out of error, you need to rectify the error. And if they did it intentionally, over and above the punishment, if you rectify it, there is a chance that Allah might forgive them. And this is why we say, let us not punish those who've passed away from our families who have written wrong wills. Go and correct it. Remember one thing that is so beautiful. All the schools of thought are united when it comes to the laws of inheritance. The basic principles of the laws of inheritance, all the schools of thought, all the madhabs and all the different types of the Muslims agree to that. Because the details are in the Quran. There is no ways that we are allowed to sway this way or that way. Say for example, a person has an illegitimate child. May Allah protect us all. The illegitimate child will not inherit because they are illegitimate. They will not inherit from the portions that Allah has decreed. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives you up to 33.3%, and from that you might decide to write, to give that biological child a certain amount and they will get it. They will receive it if you've written it. Even if they are illegitimate and even if they are not Muslim. Even if they are not related to you in any way. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us that understanding. So if you haven't written anything, the illegitimate child will not get a penny. That is why it is important to write it down and register it with your lawyer or the accountant, with the high courts and so on, depending on the law of your land. And it's important that anyone who has any amount of wealth, you need to write down what you'd like to do with that wealth. If you are living in a non-Muslim country, it is very important that you visit the ulama. You go and see the forms that you have in order to fill them properly so that your will can be written and registered with the courts of this land, so that the day you die, it will be executed Islamically, because we are not living in an Islamic country. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us understanding. Now let's go to the first verse. The first verse connected to the splitting of wealth. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks to us very beautifully. And in fact, before I mention this first verse, there is one more very serious point. The laws of inheritance are the only laws where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, whoever does not fulfill these laws, they will go into Jahannam, into hellfire forever and ever.
وَمَنْ يَعْصِ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ وَيَتَعَدَّ حُدُودَهُ يُدْخِلْهُ نَارًا خَالِدًا فِيهَا وَلَهُ عَذَابٌ مُهِينٌ.
Whoever does not fulfill these particular limits of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the decree of Allah regarding the laws of inheritance, Allah says they will go into hellfire forever and ever, and that will be a severe punishment for them. Now, the Mufassirin have interpreted it in different ways. You and I know that a Muslim will not be in hellfire forever and ever. At some point they will come out. So why is the term forever and ever used here? Number one, some of the ulama say it is to show you the long duration of the stay in Jahannam, in hell. May Allah protect us. The others say that because there are verses of the Quran that explicitly mention the portions, if you did not give one portion to one person, you lost your Islam and your Iman and you're no longer a Muslim. Because to deny one verse of the Quran, you lose your whole Iman. And if you've lost your Iman, you can now fall into the category where Allah says, go into Jahannam forever and ever. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. This is so serious that the Sahaba radiallahu anhum used to make sure that they split the inheritance to the T. And whenever they were told something, whenever they were not sure about something, they went to ask the most knowledgeable. And whenever there was a ruling made, they followed it to the T, because they did not want a few dollars and a few grams of gold and a few ounces in this dunya to result in them going into hellfire. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us all. Now let's get to that verse. Allah says,
يُوصِيكُمُ اللَّهُ فِي أَوْلَادِكُمْ لِلذَّكَرِ مِثْلُ حَظِّ الْأُنْثَيَيْنِ.
Allah commands you. Allah instructs you. He makes it obligatory upon you. It is compulsory upon you that your children, male and female, they get your wealth after your death in such a way that the male child will receive double the share of a female child. That is justice. Allahu Akbar. Now let's pause there for a moment. The male child will receive double that of a female child. So if there are $75,000, the male will get $50,000 and the female will get $25,000. Many people might be thinking that is not fair. Let me explain to you today, that is the most fair judgment. That is honoring a woman beyond what myself and yourselves could have comprehended had it not been for the explanation of the Creator. Let me now explain to you. There are non-Muslims and there are some Muslims who are weak, who don't have knowledge, who say, how come Islam dishonors a woman by giving her half that of what a man gets when they are both equally related to the deceased? The answer is no. To a fool, it might seem for a moment, may Allah protect us, that the woman has less. But to an intellectual who has studied Islam, he will know that that means a woman has more. Let me explain to you. She got $25,000 and he got $50,000. I am telling you properly from knowledge that she has more than him. Now let me explain. And you will smile when you hear. Allahu Akbar.
I told you moments ago that a woman, she has no financial obligations at all. No obligations at all. Her food, clothing and accommodation is whose duty? The closest male relative. So when there is a brother and a sister, who is the closest male relative? The brother. The 25,000 she got is only hers, extras for cosmetics and for doing whatever she pleases and for saving and investing. Whereas the 50,000 he got, the poor man has to look after his wife, he has to look after his mother and the same sister who got 25,000 and himself and his children. Now there are 8 people sharing the 50,000 and her 25, she is the queen. She is the queen sitting back, relaxing, buying all her cosmetics and enjoying life. Subhanallah. And she still goes to the brother and says, hang on, I got my 25 but I need you to pay my rent here. Allahu Akbar. The man says, but I only got 50. Now you tell me who got more. So let us understand, if the closest male relative is not fulfilling his Islamic duty, why must you blame the Islamic law? For what? And this is why, let's move to the next part of the verse. Powerful. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the creator. He says, I know how this wealth should be distributed fairly. And what I do is the most fair. And it is the most protective over the females. Listen to what Allah says.
فَإِن كُنَّ نِسَاءً فَوْقَ اثْنَتَيْنِ فَلَهُنَّ ثُلُثَا مَا تَرَكْ.
If there is no son, and there are 2 daughters or more than 2 daughters, then they must get 2/3 of the entire estate. Subhanallah, that is the biggest share you can ever hear of when it comes to the laws of inheritance. 2/3 is going to these 2 daughters because there's no son. Why did Allah give these girls such a huge share? No male ever gets 2/3. It is only 2 sisters if they are the closest to the deceased, or the 2 children, the 2 daughters if they are the closest to the deceased, and there is no equivalent male relative with the same link to the deceased. Then they will get 2/3 of the wealth. Do you know why? There are many reasons. One of them is, the minute you don't have a person who is a male related to the dead person with a similar link as you and you are a female, there is a chance that the closest male relative to you might not really look after you properly. So you need more wealth. Subhanallah. Subhanallah. So now the closest male relative is an uncle. So Allah says, no, hang on, the uncle must look after you. But still we want to give you 2/3 just in case. May Allah protect us all. Subhanallah. And that 2/3 is a large amount. It is the biggest share that is ever spoken about in the laws of inheritance in Islam. It is for females. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala continues. I'm sure all the women must be smiling. Subhanallah. And they must be thinking, not how big the share is, but how they're going to go to all the men and tell them, hey, my food, my clothing, my accommodation, your responsibility. Remember one thing, and this is on a serious note, but also on a light note. You can't come and claim, right, you owe me accommodation, I'm going to V&A. Every night you need to pay the bill. And you owe me, for example, food, so I'm going every day to eat out at Nando's, subhanallah. So you need to pay my bill. No. He needs to pay what is reasonable according to his capacity and according to the level that is known within the area that you are living and within the families you are living in. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us understanding. Now Allah continues. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says,
وَإِن كَانَتْ وَاحِدَةً فَلَهَا النِّصْفُ.
If she is just one daughter, one female, one daughter, or the closest child, the closest female child to the deceased is a sister, just one. She gets half of the wealth, half of the entire estate, 50%. That also is one of the biggest shares. It is the second biggest share that is ever spoken about in inheritance. Subhanallah. Take a look at that. Look at the justice of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And why? Because again, if she is one, she needs some wealth. There might be a person who is close to them as a male or the closest male relative who might not be fulfilling their duty, like what is happening on the globe today. In the Western cultures, they have now enslaved a female and told her, no, you must go out to work. What's the idea? They are fooling the female. You must go out to work. You must earn money. You must have your own wealth and so on. Then when it comes to the rent, they say, hey, 50-50. Allahu Akbar. Look how they ran away. When it comes to food, they say, you must chip in 50-50. Whereas a Muslim male with a Muslim female, he must say, listen, if you work, it's your money. I am still responsible for 100% of the food, clothing and accommodation. If you want to help me, it's your goodness. If not, then it's still your right. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all comfort in our homes and contentment. This is why let's not be fooled by all different cultures and modernization that come to us from behind the brain, not from in front of it. They come from behind the brain and they con us, telling us, you know what, you are not treating your females equally. In fact, today I was contacted by someone saying they read an article where it was written that the Muslim females are putting bags, bin bags on their heads, and they are made and subjected by their males to become little tools and objects, and they are oppressed. Allahu Akbar. I would not even respond to something of that nature, because they know they just want fame and glory. Those who want to attack Islam nowadays, they want fame and glory. They know that their own daughters are thinking about converting to Islam, and this is why it's becoming dangerous for them. So this is the only way. Someone sent me an email, very interesting. They showed me, and this is very, very interesting. They say, when a woman covers her nose and her mouth, then they say she is oppressed. And they say it is haram, and they want to prohibit it in certain countries. Allah sent a swine flu where the whole world is covering their mouths and faces, and even men are now in niqab. Subhanallah, anywhere you go, you see them in niqab. Allah is punishing them to say, you want the women not to wear it, we will force you to wear it. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us all. That is the power of the Creator. And people don't even realize and they don't understand. Now when the doctor comes with that mask, tell him, doctor, is your wife oppressing you? So here we have the law of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us very, very clearly that these women folk, they are meant to be looked after. If they are not being looked after, don't blame the religion. Blame the individual. Blame the situation. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all understanding. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about the parents. I've spoken about the children. Now let's speak about the parents. Now if there is one son, single son alone, he will get the remainder of the estate after the dues that are fixed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is why the one son alone is not discussed here. Because if the son is alone, or there are two sons, they will share it equally. There are three sons, they will share it equally. There are three sons and one daughter. What you do is, you count two shares for every male and one share for every female, and you will then have 6 + 1, 7 shares. You divide that estate into 7, and you then give 2 shares to every male and 1 share to every female. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us a deep understanding. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says,
وَلِأَبَوَيْهِ لِكُلِّ وَاحِدٍ مِّنْهُمَا السُّدُسُ مِمَّا تَرَكَ إِن كَانَ لَهُ وَلَدٌ.
The parents will receive 1/6. The parents will receive 1/6 each if the person who died has a child. That is very simple. Look at the justice in it. If the person who died has a child, the child needs to get something. So let's give the parents 1/6 each, because they also deserve something. But if there is no child, then the mother will get 1/3 and the father will get the balance after everybody gets. Subhanallah. Why? Because they don't have a child. So who is the next closest? The parents. The strongest link to myself and yourselves when it comes to the laws of inheritance, your children. They are the strongest link when it comes to the laws of inheritance. Thereafter, your parents. That is the next link. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about it. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says,
فَإِنْ لَمْ يَكُنْ لَهُ وَلَدٌ وَوَرِثَهُ أَبَوَاهُ فَلِأُمِّهِ الثُّلُثُ.
If the man or the person who passed away does not have a child, and the parents are the ones who are inheriting, then the mother must get 1/3, the father will get the balance. The mother must get 1/3, no longer 1/6. 1/6 is a smaller portion. That is when the man has a child, or when the deceased, even if she is a female, has a child. But when she doesn't have a child, or he doesn't have a child, the mother will get 1/3 and the father will get the balance. Then Allah says,
فَإِن كَانَ لَهُ إِخْوَةٌ فَلِأُمِّهِ السُّدُسِ.
And if the deceased person has brothers or sisters, then the mother will still get 1/6. The mother will get 1/6. Why? Because now the brothers and sisters come into the picture. If they don't have children, They've got parents and they have brothers and sisters. Then the mother will get 1/6 and the brothers and sisters will then come into the picture. They will then share the balance. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect us all and to make us from those who not only understand these rules, but who apply them and put them into practice. Let's move further. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about the husband and the wife. He says, and before he says that, he tells us, you don't know who is closer to you in benefit from your parents or your children. You don't know who's going to die first. Your son might make you a rich man. When he dies, you might get his wealth. And it might be the other way around. You might die before him. And Allah says, you never know who will benefit you most.
آباؤكم وأبناؤكم لا تدرون أيهم أقرب لكم نفعا.
Your parents and your children, you do not know who are closer to you in benefit. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect us. Let me show you a few points that are mentioned under this verse. Sometimes a person has 5 sons, just an example, and 4 of them are with him. They listen to him. 1 has never asked about him, gone away, got married to a place the father wasn't happy, and possibly was swearing the father and cursing, maybe even had a few bad habits here and there. And the father comes to the ulama and says, I want to block this son from getting anything because he is very, very disobedient. That is completely haram. It is forbidden. Didn't I tell you moments ago? You don't decide who's going to get. Allah decides. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decides. You will not block your son or your daughter even if you don't like them. May Allah protect us. You cannot block your father or your mother even if you don't like them. You cannot do that. You cannot block anyone Allah has given, even if they are your brothers and sisters in the case where you don't have children. Even if you don't like them, they will definitely get a share if Allah has written it, whether you like it or not. And this is why what happens sometimes is the 4 are very, very nice because they know dad is very rich. Soon as he dies, I'm going to be a millionaire. So let's be good to him. So they're very good. That one, he says, listen, put dad in his place. I'm not worried no matter what, whether I get the money or not. If dad is committing a sin, he's committing a sin. I'm going to speak out and I'm going to say things. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. So what happens? The father then wants to stop that child. But the ulama guide the father and say, no, you cannot stop the child from inheriting. The day the father dies, those 4 will be happy enjoying their wealth. This one here might be the first one to raise his hands to say, oh Allah, forgive my father. That one dua is better than what the other 4 have ever done for that father. So Allah says, you don't know, there is a chance that that child you don't really get on with might be the only child who will remember you for long and long after your death. So that is why be fair when it comes to your children, even after you've died. If the problem is solved at that time, only Allah knows. And Allah is the one in charge. Allah is the one who owns the hearts. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us a balance and make us from amongst those who are fair and just at all times. So now, let's take a look. Sometimes you have people who say, no, I would like to sort out my money and my wealth now so that when I die, there's no problem, no fighting. That's fine. But what that would entail is as follows. You would have to take all your wealth and distribute it evenly between the males and the females and give it to them and make them the owners of it in such a way that you have nothing remaining, not even a house to live in. Then you tell your son, listen, my son, out of your goodness, can you keep me in your house until the point I die? The son says, no problem, dad. Sometimes the sons might say, dad, there's the door. If they say that, then subhanallah, the dad has to go out. The son will be punished for not having looked after his father. But subhanallah, it's his right. He's got the wealth. If the father is being a pain and interfering in the life, and that is a problem that many young couples face, interference from parents on both sides. That is what is destroying marriages. Many times marriages are destroyed not because of husband and wife, because of fathers and in-laws and mothers and mothers-in-law. May Allah protect us. Not all the time, but many times. This is why do not interfere in the independence of your children. The only time you interfere with a married couple is when they are turning away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whether they attend a function or not is none of your business. If they say, mom, we don't want to attend this, they don't have to. If they say, we don't want to come here, we don't want to eat together, no problem. Don't hate them for that. It's their right. If they say, we need our privacy, they are given that privacy by the Creator. Let them live their life. Why do you want to interfere and destroy people's marriages? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us parents and parents-in-law, whom our children and children-in-law are proud of, and not those who are cursed every time The daughter-in-law raises her hands, Ya Allah, take my mother-in-law away, Ya Allah. Malakul Maut came, the angel of death came so much in our area. Ya Allah, you're missing this address, Ya Allah. I want to tell you it's number 56, Ya Allah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. So we don't want this to happen. Live your life in such a way that people adore you. The way they are going to adore you is give them their freedom, subhanallah. Allow them to live. And this is a powerful message, probably extremely strong. I'm sure a lot of people suffer this because as a counselor, we go through so many things. We know exactly which buttons to press when we have to press them. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all protection and understanding. I see a lot of the young people smiling. I don't know whether it is a difficulty or whether it is an ease. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all goodness inshallah. So if a person then distributes his wealth, he is not allowed to say, right, I'm giving you this house, you will get that property, you will get this, you will get that. When I die, you must take it. The minute you say the word, when I die, already you have no more say, Allah has the say. So if you want to give, give it now and give it to them, make them the owners of it in your life in such a way that you have nothing. Or if you want to connect it to your death, then you don't have a say. You can't say, when I die, you get this, you get that, you get this, you get that. No. It's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who decides. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all protection and understanding. Let's move further. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us as husbands, Allah says, وَلَكُمْ نِصْفُ مَا تَرَكَ أَزْوَاجُكُمْ إِن لَّمْ يَكُنْ لَهُنَّ وَلَدٌ. For you is half of what your wives leave if they do not have children. If they do not have children. So if your wife doesn't have a child, she passes away, you get half of her estate, 50% in Islam. If she has a child, Allah says, فَإِن كَانَ لَهُنَّ وَلَدٌ فَلَكُمُ الرُّبُعُ مِمَّا تَرَكْنَا. Allah says, if they do have children, then you will only get 25% of the entire estate, not 50, because we need to take consideration of her children. You as a father might get married again, and that stepmother might not be as kind as the real mother of those children, so we now need to give a share to those children, even though you as a father are alive. Subhanallah. Look at how Allah has protected everyone. And now people want to say the laws of inheritance are not fair. Subhanallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us understanding. Some say when the spouse dies, the other spouse must take everything. That is also oppression, because what happens to the children? They also need a financial backing. They also need something. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala really open our eyes to the truth. And may He guide those who don't know the details of Islam and the Quran towards this Quran. And towards Islam, it is definitely full of justice. Listen to what Allah says thereafter.
وَلَهُنَّ الرُّبُعُ مِمَّا تَرَكْتُمْ إِن لَّمْ يَكُنْ لَكُمْ وَلَدٌ.
For them, meaning for the wives, is 25% of your wealth when you have died if you have no children. So you have no children, you pass away, your wife gets 25%. One might ask, what happens to the rest? Don't worry about what happens to the rest, it's not coming to you. You have died. May Allah grant us understanding. Rather, what happens to the rest is it goes to the others whom Allah has given the shares. The father, the mother, the brothers, the sisters, at times depending on who is the closest and so on. Then Allah says,
فَإِن كَانَ لَكُمْ وَلَدٌ فَلَهُنَّ الثُّمُنُ مِمَّا تَرَكْتُمْ.
And if you do have a child, then your wife will only get 12.5%, which is 1/8. Because your child also needs to get something. Because that wife might get married, and who knows, that husband might not financially support your child, though the mother is still alive. So Allah says, we want to protect them. Hold that wealth. And remember, never cheat the person. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us understanding. Now we've got another issue. A person passes away. They don't have parents. They don't have children. Now what to do? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala discusses this. They don't even have brothers, they don't even have sisters. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about this. Allah says,
وَإِن كَانَ رَجُلٌ يُورَثُ كَلَالَةً أَوْ إِمْرَأَةً وَلَهُ أَخٌ أَوْ أُخْتٌ فَلِكُلِّ وَاحِدٍ مِّنْهُمَا السُّدُسُ فَإِن كَانُوا أَكْثَرَ مِنْ ذَلِكَ فَهُمْ شُرَكَاءُ فِي الثُّلُثِ.
Allah says, if a person passes away, they have no ascendance, no descendants, but they only have a step brother or sister from the mother, then that brother or sister from the mother, if they do have that, will get a sixth if they are alone. And if they are more than one, then they will share one third. Now the question comes, obviously this is about a step brother and sister from the mother. What about a person who's got real brothers and sisters, so they don't have mothers and fathers, or they don't have children, but real brothers and sisters? Allah says at the end of Surah An-Nisa, very beautiful. You see, these verses are at the beginning of Surah Nisa. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about so many other rules and regulations pertaining to women in that same surah. And right at the end, He ends with another rule about inheritance. Do you know why? Some of the ulama of tafsir say, it is because when the men and when the Muslims read Surah Nisa, they will read the laws of inheritance, it will wake them up. But by the time they read all the other things, they might become oblivious of it. So Allah says at the end, we put one more verse to remind you of everything else that went back. Allahu Akbar. So that's why when we end the surah, we end with one more verse to tell you, listen, don't forget what we just told you. Allahu Akbar. Listen to what Allah says. Yastaftunak, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they ask you a decree. They are asking you a question. About what? About a prayer.
Illahu yuftikum fil kalala. إن امرؤ هلك ليس له ولد وله أخت فلها نصف ما ترك.
Allah says, Allah will give you the ruling about al-kalala. What is the meaning of kalala? Listen very carefully. The Arabic sounds very interesting. مَنْ لَا وَلَدَ لَهُ وَلَا وَالِدٍ. A person who has no children, no parents. That is kalala. That is a person who is kalala, male or female. So what if a person has passed away as kalala? Meaning no children, no parents. Allah says, if they have a sister, the sister gets half. Subhanallah. 50% of the wealth the sister gets. Then what happens to the rest? It goes to the nearest. Now the uncles and aunts come into the picture and so on. We are not going to go into that detail because we've only got 1 hour to speak. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, if there are more than one sisters without any brothers, if she is a single sister without a brother, she gets half of his wealth, of the brother's wealth. Imagine a sister can inherit from a brother if she is the only relative and the brother has no children, no parents. And then if there are more than one sisters, Allah says, فَإِن كَانَتَ اثْنَتَيْنِ فَلَهُمَا الثُّلُثَانِ مِمَّا تَرَكْ. If there are more than one, if there are two of them, Allah says they get two-thirds of the entire estate. Who's going to look after them? But even if they are married, they're still going to get two-thirds. Subhanallah. What a lucky husband. MashaAllah. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says,
وَإِن كَانُوا إِخْوَةً رِجَالًا وَنِسَاءً فَلِلذَّكَرِ مِثْلُ حَظِّ الْأُنْثَيَيْنِ يُبَيِّنُ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ أَن تَضِلُّوا وَاللَّهُ بِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ عَلِيمٌ.
If there are brothers and sisters, then they will share it in such a way that the male will get double that of a female. And I told you that in essence is giving more to the female. Didn't we start off like that? Subhanallah, we are also ending like that. Allah says, Allah has made these laws very clear for you so that you are not led astray. Allah is all wise and all knowledgeable. So these are some of the most important rules of inheritance. Look at the detail in which the Quran has spoken about it. I think it is our duty that after this appetizer of the laws of inheritance, we all make it our business to go out and learn what Allah says about inheritance. We don't have a say when it comes to after death. It will happen the way Allah wants it to happen. Yes, I did tell you the one third. Allah is the one who gave us a discretion with certain conditions. And this is why we are not allowed to give a person who has already got a fixed portion in the Quran. Let me mention a few more very interesting points. When is a person blocked from inheriting? When will they not inherit? That's a good question. One of the times when a person will not inherit is if he or she was the murderer of the one they are supposed to have inherited from. If he or she had murdered the one whom they were supposed to inherit from, they won't inherit. Not at all. Not in a million years. Because Allah needs to protect a rich man from his own sons first, before others. And from his own daughters. I've heard of stories where a big life policy is taken out on someone and the son kills the person in order to get the money from that insurance. May Allah protect us. So Allah says, if there is homicide there, if there is murder there, you won't get a penny. You won't even get a penny, not even a rand, not even a dollar, not even a gram. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all protection. Al-qatilu la yarif. The one who kills will not inherit from the one they've killed. So that is one. Another issue, a person who is not a Muslim. I've touched on this at the beginning, but let me just end with it. If a person is not a Muslim, sometimes people say, oh, the son is not a Muslim, the father's not a Muslim, they're not going to inherit. That statement is accurate, but inaccurate. Which means they won't inherit from Allah's shares. Because when Allah says your sons get so much, He's talking of the Muslim sons. Your daughters, your children, He's talking of the Muslims. Your husband, your father, your mother, He's talking of the Muslims. If you have any of these relatives who are not Muslims, now Allah says up to 33%. For as long as your entire bequest does not exceed 33%, you are allowed to write for them a will on condition that it is witnessed and signed and authenticated how much you would like that non-Muslim child or parent or brother or sister to get, and the total amount must not exceed 33.3%. And the last point I'd like to end with is, it is very important that we draw up our wills. Very important. Utmost importance. If we die intestate, intestate means without a will, then I don't know what is the law of the land here in this country, but sometimes your wealth might not be distributed properly. Let us go and attend seminars which teach us the laws of inheritance. And it is important also when you write something down, even if you're writing it on a piece of paper, get witnesses to witness and sign. Get witnesses to witness and sign. Don't think I've told my children and that's enough. No, get witnesses, independent witnesses to witness and sign what you've written. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all Jannah and save us from hellfire. Remember, a person who denies even one of the laws of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from the Quran may well be losing their iman and may well be cast in hellfire. We don't want that to happen. May Allah forgive us. If anyone has usurped anyone's wealth in any way, give it back today before tomorrow. Phone them tonight and tell them, listen, my dear sister, we cheated you, we undervalued the property, I owe you 3 million rands, please give me 2 years to pay you. The sister, subhanallah, might even cry, and subhanallah, it might be the means of our entry into Jannah. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabina Muhammad. Subhanallah bihamdih. Subhanakallahumma bihamdika. Nashhadu an la ilaha illa anta, nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayka.